prison. Amen. That's why we're here. And it's a great thing when the Church of God comes together and to celebrate something as great as this. I think Holy Friday, Good Friday, was obviously very, very important, but just as important as Sunday morning, 2 days later. And so we praise God that not only ourselves, but people around Elgin, Texas, and America, and the whole world are celebrating this day. You know, that's what brings us together. I'm going to invite you to stand that we might read the call to worship, Psalm 16. The Lord is my chosen portion and my cup. You hold my lot.
The lines have fallen for me in the pleasant places. I have a glorious heritage.
I bless the Lord who gives me counsel. Even at night my heart instructs me.
I have set the Lord always before me. The Lord is at my right hand. I shall not be moved.
Therefore my heart is glad and my soul rejoices. My body also dwells secure.
For you do not give me enough to show, or let your God be one to see the dead.
You show me the path of life. In your presence there is fullness of joy. In your right hand are pleasures forevermore. Amen.
Amen.
Let us sing together, Alas, and Did My Savior Bleed. And Lord, we know that there is no way to capture the full meaning of that moment. But we are living it. For the power of God is in our soul. And we are so thankful, Lord, so grateful. Because while we were yet sinners and miserable and wretched, Christ died for us, but he also rose for us. And so, Father, everything that we're about to do it for your honor and glory. And we pray in Jesus' name that you would accept our worship. But at the same time, come to us, Father. Move us, convince us, convict us, encourage us, empower us, fill us, according to your divine will, for your divine purposes, that the name of the Lord God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit might be glorified. We thank you, Father, in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Brothers and sisters, as we go forward, we want to recite the Nicene Creed. Usually we recite the Apostles' Creed, but today we want to read the extended version, you could say, of the Creed, the Nicene Creed. So we believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and all that is seen and unseen.
We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made.
For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate of the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and became truly human. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end.
We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, and has spoken through the prophets.
We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church.
We acknowledge one baptism
for the forgiveness of sins.
We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life.
I invite you to stand, brothers and sisters, if you wish, to sing these couple of songs to the honor and glory of God.
Thank you.
But on the first day of the week, at early dawn, they came to the tomb, taking the spices they had prepared. They found the stone rolled away from the tomb, but when they went in, they did not find the body. While they were perplexed about this, suddenly two men in dazzling clothes stood beside them. The women were terrified and bowed their faces to the ground, but the men said to them, "Why do you look for the living among the dead? He is not here, but has risen. Remember how he told you while he was still in Galilee that the Son of Man must be handed over to sinners and be crucified, and on the third day rise again." Then they remembered his words, and returning from the tomb, they told all this to the 11 and to all the rest. Now it was Mary Magdalene, Joanna, Mary, the mother of James, and the other women with them who told this to the apostles. But these words seemed to them an idle tale, and they did not believe them. But Peter got up and ran to the tomb. Stooping and looking in, he saw the linen cloths by themselves. Then he went home, amazed at what had happened. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Amen.
I think that's exactly how it happened. The only thing is that of course we don't see everything here, but I think that with the earthquake and the brightness of the resurrected Jesus, that's what caused the Roman soldiers to faint, to fall in terror. And if you can imagine Navy SEALs just falling as dead, scared to death. That's exactly what happened. And every year we try to find a new angle, a new perspective, as I've said this week, into the story of Jesus and his resurrection or his death. And we could spend this morning, the next few minutes, talking about that exactly, about the actual resurrection. But I want us to focus on something that is often overlooked. And yes, we love to talk about the resurrection and how it complements Ugly Friday. But between Friday and Sunday morning, where was Jesus? Where was Jesus? He was where everybody else goes. Sheol, or Hades, or the place of the dead. And today we read the Nicene Creed, but usually we read the Apostles' Creed. And if you look at your hymn book, well, you don't look at the hymn book right now, but 888 in your hymn book, there's an asterisk. And that asterisk during the Apostles' Creed, you read at the bottom, it says, and he descended into hell. That is not usually read, but it was in the original. That is to say, he descended into the place of the dead, Sheol, Hades. Now, Jesus of Nazareth had been dead at least 30 hours, because we don't know exactly what time he resurrected from the dead. Not that it matters. But he had been dead at least 30 hours. And at daybreak, notice, how come there's four women? There's at least four women, maybe more. Thank you, man. There was at least four women who came to finish the job that Nicodemus and Joseph of Arimathea could not finish because Saturday was coming, the new day was coming upon them. And so the angel says, why do you seek the living among the dead? Well, the women, they could have said, well, because the last time we saw him Friday afternoon, he was dead. Just like all human beings are dead. And we place him in his burial and we come and we wrap him again the next day if necessary. That's why we're here. We're looking for the dead. And they would have been absolutely right. But where is this place of the dead? What is this place of the dead? Very quickly, in the Old Testament, several times it says that when somebody dies, the Lord tells them, you shall be gathered into the company of your fathers. That is to say, you'll be collected, you will be added to their number. The English Bibles read pit or hell or underworld or the grave or the word Sheol, which means these things. Where people die, where people go when they die. The book of Numbers says of the rebellious Korah who stood up against Moses, that the earth opened up and he swallowed them, their families and their property, and they went alive into Sheol. In Isaiah 14, speaking of the king of Tyre, it says, below, Sheol is stirring, waiting for your coming. So in the Old Testament, Sheol, the place of the dead, or Hades in the Greek, is inside the earth. It's somewhere inside the earth. People don't die and go to heaven. That is not a Christian teaching. People do not go and go to heaven, die and go to heaven. That's not where we go. We go where Jesus went, which was into the place of the dead, Sheol or Hades or even paradise. Didn't Jesus say? And the New Testament affirms this teaching, because even Jesus himself says in Matthew 12, "For as Jonas was 3 days and three nights in the belly of a whale, so shall the man, Son of Man, be 3 days and three nights in the heart of the earth." So human death is not just about not breathing on earth. When our heart stops, you must continue the journey into the place of the dead. And that's why we read, "And he descended into hell." Hell, not the place of punishment, hell, the place of the dead, like any other human being. Now, we're not going to speculate what he did there. Is it a lonely place? Is it full of people? Is it beautiful? Is it rocky? Can you see the flames from afar? You know, with Abraham, remember that story of Abraham and Lazarus? They're on one side and they look over, and there's the rich man, and he's crying out, "Look, I'm here in the flames. You guys are okay over there." And we're not going to speculate about that. But when we speak of Jesus being raised from the dead, we overlook the meaning of the word dead. In English, dead can mean the state of being without life. But it can also mean, as it should have been translated, the plural of a dead person, which is dead ones. In Spanish, it's very clear, because we say, "Cristo resucitó de entre los muertos." Many, many dead people. So when we say that Jesus was raised from the dead, we are really saying that Jesus was raised from among the dead ones. Which means that when he died, he went to be with the people who were already dead for thousands of years. Those people are there. In the heart of the earth, let's say. And I want you to know, brothers and sisters, that Jesus remained. Think about what I'm going to say. Jesus remained powerless as a dead man. Jesus remained powerless as a dead human being, as any dead human being would be in the place of the dead. You have no power. Jesus did not resurrect himself. He did not exert his own power as a divine one, as the eternal word, as the creator of the universe. He did not exert his own power and just raise himself to death. That's not what the Bible says. He did not even do it when he wanted to. The plan of salvation was for Jesus to remain lifeless, powerless, until the Father raised him. That's what the Bible teaches. Every time that the scriptures say that he resurrected, for example, in the book of Acts, 11 times it says that God raised him from the dead. It never says that Jesus raised himself. When I think of my own parents, my own mother, who died almost a year ago, she cannot resurrect herself. She cannot come out of the grave, remake her body, and come and see me. She doesn't have that power, and neither did Jesus. And even if he did have it, well, we know that he's a divine male. But he did not use it. Because he's taking our place. He took our place as a human being, so he accepted the plan of salvation, which was to go into Sheol, the place of the dead, and be absolutely powerless to raise himself. And he just waited for the Father to raise him, as the book of Acts says, 11 times. But why are we talking about this morning? Because this is the secret to being born again. To trust in God Almighty absolutely for your own resurrection. For your own resurrection of your soul. When we say that we are dead in our sins, I want you to understand that we're like Jesus in Sheol. We're absolutely dead. We cannot raise ourselves. We cannot bring life, the life of God, into ourselves. We are waiting for God to raise us. There is no such thing as self-transformation. There is no such thing. When you believe in the Lord Jesus Christ and you receive Him, you do not only die on the cross with Him, but you go to Sheol as well, as it were, to the place of the dead. Because even though you are dead to sin, you have no life. In fact, because of sin, no one should get out. But because of our faith in Jesus Christ, you await the newness of life to be injected into your own soul. I can stop sinning. I can stop cursing. I can stop doing all kinds of things. I can modify my life. I can change everything. But that will not give me the life of God. God Himself must inject and plant His new life in me. Then I'm born again. This is why Jesus went to the place of the dead and waited until God the Father called him and empowered him to come out. And so we see the resurrection of Jesus, which is why we're here, which is why we have sight and understanding, and we have a conscience that's living, and we have a love for God because of what He did. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. I'm going to invite you to stand as we sing our hymn, He Lives.
I sure have risen Savior, He's in the world today.
here today, we come in representation, and well, of course, those who are watching us on Facebook, but we come in representation for others who can't come this morning. And so God bless you. And don't forget, we have a breakfast waiting in the fellowship hall for you all. Let us be dismissed. Gracious Father, blessed be your name for your kindness and goodness, that not only did you go to the cross to kill our sin, but you resurrected from the dead on the third day that we might have newness of life. Allow us to live that fully, especially in this time in this world that so much needs the gospel of Jesus Christ. Help us to share that hope with others, even during this week that is coming. And now may the love of God the Father, the love of God the Son, the power and the presence of the Holy Spirit be with you now and forever. Amen.
Amen. Amen.